Well, this lady was fantastic, and I never heard of her before. Name is Cecilia Payne. Turns out that she made a very critical contribution in determining that most of the composition of stars, including the sun, is hydrogen and helium, and didn't really get the credit for it. In fact, another astronomer, Norris, actually sort of claimed the credit for it, a guy named Norris. And we'll talk about it in more detail.
He stole it and took it as his, even though it's theirs.
Yeah. And that happened to a lot of women.
Oh, no.
Yeah,
I know, women were nothing.
They were assistants, or they were, you know, one of the outstanding examples where it didn't happen was Madame Curie.
Yeah.
Her husband shared, and in fact gave her most of the credit for their discoveries. So we'll go through a timeline. We'll talk about, in some detail, about how elements can be uniquely identified using spectral analysis. Talk about the effect of ionization on temperature, and then the effect of, the effect of temperature on ionization. And then the effect of ionization on the spectrum. Talk a little bit about the origin and abundance of elements in the universe, and relate that to the composition of the human body in terms of basic elements. It's kind of interesting. That's kind of a side topic that I came across. And we'll talk about the composition of stars, what happened in the Big Bang and how elements initially were formed, and then a little bit about the cosmic background radiation, and summarize. So Cecilia Payne was born in 1900, died in 1979, born in Britain, became an American citizen, and in her 1925 doctoral thesis, she proposed that stars were composed primarily of hydrogen and helium. It contradicted the scientific wisdom of the time, which said that the composition of stars was the same as the composition of Earth. Okay? And of course, Earth has very little hydrogen and helium. Most of the hydrogen on Earth is in the water. Okay, combined with oxygen, H2O, and very little helium. So she actually recanted. She didn't pursue that, but eventually she was proven to be correct. So we'll go through her story and some of the interesting things that led up to it, her discovery, and then talk a bit about the elements in the universe. Yes.
Was she still alive when they realized she was right? Did she know?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay, good.
Oh, yeah. But it's what's amazing is, two things are amazing. One is, I never heard of her.
Yeah, that's true.
And I have to give credit, Jane's not here, but she'll be in a little bit later, I think. But Jane is the one that found her name. And the other interesting thing is, kind of amazing thing is, I never heard of her.
Which is rare, yeah.
And the other interesting thing is that it wasn't until like around 1930 that we actually knew that stars were primarily composed of hydrogen and helium. That, you know, I thought that would have been known much earlier. Yeah.
Well, they could have easily looked at the spectrograph of a star and seen the hydrogen. I guess no one did. Or
yeah. People disregarded it for some reason.
How did they explain its burning?
She was born in Wendover, England. Her father was a lawyer and a historian and very accomplished musician. And unfortunately, he passed away when she was 4 years old, Her mother had to raise a family on her own with three children. In 1919, she won a scholarship to Cambridge, studied botany, physics, and chemistry. She went to a lecture by Eddington. Now, Eddington, of course, was the British scientist who proved that Newton was wrong, which didn't make him very popular with the Royal Academy, by photographing the positions of stars during an eclipse, that were the stars that were near the sun in terms of line of sight, and showing that their visual position was shifted because the light was bent by the gravitational field of the sun. And that was in line with Einstein's theory. He came out with that theory in 1915, the general theory of relativity, and Eddington did his work in 1919, so it took 4 years. And of course, as soon as he came out with that proof, and there was another set of proofs from, I believe, a Russian scientist, Einstein became world famous because his theory had been proven. Anyway, she said, after hearing the lecture, the result was a complete transformation of my world picture. My world had been so shaken that I experienced something very like a nervous breakdown. She completed her studies, but Cambridge couldn't give her a degree because they didn't give women degrees until, get this, 1948.
Wow.
It's kind of amazing. So you could complete all the work and you didn't get a degree.
Especially if you knew more than they did.
It didn't slow her down though. 1923, she found a grant, met Harlow Shapley, who talked about last week, and he was the director of Harvard College Observatory at the time, and got a fellowship to study at the observatory. In 1925, her doctoral thesis accurately related the spectral classes of stars to their actual temperatures by applying an ionization theory developed by an Indian physicist named Saha. She showed that the great variation, and we'll talk more in detail about this, in the absorption lines of spectra was due to different amounts of ionization at different temperatures. So the hotter an atom got, it makes sense, the more energy was available to these electrons, and the more likely it was that they would leave the atom, which is the process of ionization, okay? So an electron leaves an atom, it means that it leaves the atom with a net positive charge, because you're taking away a negative charge. So an ordinary atom is neutral, same number of protons and electrons. Take an electron away, then there's an excess of protons which are positively charged, so you have a positive ion. She found that all common elements were present in the same relative amounts as Earth, but hydrogen and helium were millions of times more abundant in stars. Okay. So the strength of the spectral lines depends on the temperature of the stars, not just the abundance of certain elements. That was her major contribution, and it was a very significant one, very significant. In reviewing, it wasn't Norris, it was Russell. His middle name was Norris. This astronomer, who was her mentor at Harvard, dissuaded her from concluding that the composition of the sun was predominantly hydrogen, because the general consensus at the time was that the sun and the earth were similar. He had written in an academic article in 1914, the agreement of the solar and terrestrial list is such as to confirm very strongly Roland's opinion, another astronomer, that if the earth's crust should be raised to the temperature of the sun's atmosphere, it would give a very similar absorption spectrum.
Wasn't Russell the guy with Hertzberg?
Yeah.
Star chart.
So if Russell were alive today, you might hear him be very supportive and maybe even sing the following. In case you're not familiar with the song, it's Cecilia.
Thank you.
So anyway, you know, he was not very well liked by Cecilia in the end, and he was proven wrong.
Yeah.
She subsequently described her results as spurious because here was this famous scientist, astronomer, telling her she was wrong. And he was her mentor and probably on her doctoral committee. Yeah. So she had to recant. But another astronomer named Struve eventually said that her work was the most brilliant PhD thesis ever written in astronomy. Russell also realized she was correct and eventually gave her some credit, but he is the one that is often credited for the conclusions that she reached.
Yeah, he stole it from her and said it was him.
Yeah.
It was a beast.
So there's a picture of her with one of her, and she had about 150 different publications. Various articles, or thesis, scientific papers. In 1933, she met a Russian-born astrophysicist named Gapashkin in Germany, and the next year she helped him get a visa to the United States, and they got married and settled in Lexington, Mass., short commute from Harvard. In 1943, she was elected as a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Began teaching at Harvard and eventually became the first female head of the astronomy department at Harvard.
Wow.
So even without a bachelor's degree, she got a doctorate, of course, from Harvard. But she didn't have a bachelor's degree from Cambridge because they couldn't give her a degree.
Because she was a woman.
Yeah, they didn't give women degrees until 1948.
Wow.
And so she became a full professor at Harvard, head of the astronomy department, and eventually became emeritus professor of Harvard. And then passed away in 1979 on Pearl Harbor Day. So let's talk a little bit about how spectra are formed. What happens is that if there's excess energy impinging on an atom, sometimes an electron will jump to a higher energy level. I say sometimes because the amount of energy required for an electron to jump to a higher level, higher energy orbit has to be exact. We know that energy is quantized. So we know that, for example, in a particular frequency of light, the amount of energy is a very specific amount. if that amount of energy impinging on an atom is just right for a difference between two of the orbitals, then the electron will absorb it and jump to a higher energy level. If there's too much energy or too little, the electron will not jump. It has to be just right. And we know that in light and all electromagnetic radiation, energy is quantized, okay? So it comes in packages. It's very discrete. It's very exact. It's not a continuum, okay? So if you get just that right amount of energy, which means just the right frequency of the light, you will get an electron to jump. Now, once it jumps, if the energy isn't constantly coming in, okay, or if it's just not the right amount of energy for another jump, the electron will fall back down. It will get rid of that excess energy and emit photons, electromagnetic energy, at that frequency, okay?
How do we know all of this?
Question?
How do we know all of this? We've never seen an electron.
No, all we can do is present. Well, we've detected electrons. Yes, we have detected them. We haven't seen them, no. They're exceedingly small. It would be very hard to see them, but we've detected their presence. We know that they have a negative charge. And now that Jane is here, I want to give her credit for finding Cecilia Payne.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
You mentioned.
But we know that the electrons exist because we can send a beam of particles, and we see that some of the particles are negatively charged when they enter a magnetic field or an electric field, and so we know they're negatively charged. Okay?
This concept of them moving up and down.
Yeah, in an atom.
In an atom.
They're vibrating, basically.
We don't really, this is a we conceive this,
Well, we detect the spectra. Okay? And that's what I'm trying to explain now, yeah. So when the electron jumps back down from energy level 2 to energy level 1, it produces electromagnetic radiation, in some cases visible light. In some cases it could be X-rays or it could be infrared, okay? But in some cases it's visible light. And we call those frequencies of light that are coming out of this atom spectra, okay? Spectra because they were thought to only exist temporarily, okay? It was a spectral image. Okay? So that's where spectra come from. And if we cause excitement of a gas, for example, like hydrogen, we can burn it actually, and then we can send the light that's coming out from that burning hydrogen through a prism or a diffraction grating to separate the light into its various frequencies, and we get a spectrum. And I'll show you a picture of it. There we go. Okay? So for hydrogen, there are lots of different energy levels that have been identified based on the frequencies of the light that's coming out. Okay? So the first series here is called the Lyman series, and it ends up with an electron coming back down to the lowest energy level in the atom. Okay? The second series, which is called the Balmer series, comes down to the second lowest level. And the third series, called the Passion series, comes down to the third level. There are a couple of others too. That's not all of the series that we found. So if we look at the Balmer series, if an electron comes from this energy level to this one in returning after it's been excited, it produces a line in the spectrum of hydrogen in the red visible light region. And here is a picture of it. Can you all see that? Okay, so we get a red line on the spectrum. So you'll notice it's not a continuous spectrum, okay? There are gaps at very specific frequencies, and the frequency, and I didn't point this out on the previous slide, but the frequency is basically, or the difference in energy is basically the Planck's constant, H, times the frequency, okay? So this is the Greek letter representing frequency. So that's what's happening in the hydrogen atom. And for every atom, there is a unique set of series that's different from every other element. So every element has a very unique fingerprint, so to speak, spectral fingerprint, that enables us to identify it exactly. So if we see this set, this pattern of spectral lines, we know that we've got hydrogen. No other element produces exactly that same pattern. Make sense? Okay, questions? Good. I'll read this for you because it's kind of small. Some elements emit light mainly of just one color. It's possible to identify the element in a sample by performing a flame test. This involves heating the sample in a flame, causing it to vaporize and emit radiation at its characteristic frequencies and give a clearly visible color to the flame. The element sodium, for example, gives a strong yellow color. Many elements can be easily identified in this way. So this is burning sodium metal and oxygen. And you will notice that the emission spectrum of sodium has a strong yellow line. And the what we'll talk about later, the absorption spectrum, you'll notice that there is absorption in the yellow range of visible light at exactly the same frequency. Now, there are also molecular spectra. Molecules can also produce emission spectra, which result from changes in the way they vibrate or rotate. So not only can we identify elements, we can identify compounds, okay, molecular compounds. These involve lower energies and tend to produce emissions in the infrared part of the spectrum. So infrared would be below the red end of the visible spectrum. So we can't see the visible lines, but we can detect them with infrared detectors. Infrared basically is heat, okay? Astronomers have identified a variety of interesting molecules in space through infrared spectroscopy, and the technique is often used in organic chemistry, about which I know very little. Absorption spectra, then, what happens is, if some kind of gas, let's say, gets in between a source and the observer, and a particular frequency is absorbed by the gas, then there will be an absence of that frequency in what is observed. So the gas is actually absorbing the energy at that frequency of visible light, or infrared or ultraviolet. In an absorption spectrum, then, some wavelengths of light are absorbed as they pass through a gas, forming a pattern of dark lines against a continuous background. Elements absorb the same wavelengths that they emit. So this can be used in the same way to identify those elements. For example, light from the sun passing through the atmosphere of Venus produces an absorption spectrum that allows scientists to determine the composition of the atmosphere of Venus. And now we've seen exoplanets, planets outside the solar system, when they pass in front of their star, we can look at those planets and say, aha, this is the element or elements that are in the atmosphere of that planet. Amazing. There's actually two lines in the yellow area. It's hard to distinguish them in this picture, but there's a, what's called a doublet. They're very close together in frequency. And these are the wavelengths of 588.9950 and 589.5924 nanometers. Or nanometers, billionths of a meter, right? Yeah. So they're very, very close together. It's a very small difference in distance between the wavelengths, which means a very small difference in frequency. Any questions on that so far? Everybody understand emission and absorption spectrum? Okay. So we'll talk more about each one. So this is how an emission spectrum can be observed, okay? Light is coming in, let's say from the sun, and it can be broken up into its various frequencies, in other words, its various colors, okay? Because it turns out that in the human eye, different frequencies will excite different parts of the retina of the eye. And that will send different levels of signal to the brain, which we then interpret as color. So color is simply a matter of frequency.
Isn't that bending the wrong way?
I'm sorry?
That's glass in the middle, isn't it bending the wrong way?
The prism is glass.
Yeah. I think they've got the... Okay,
yeah. Not my picture, I stole it. I claim no credit. Well, there are, because there's an extra reflection in the raindrop.
Oh.
So you can see two rainbows, one will be reversed from the other.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it can't go both ways.
Yeah.
That's been a particular way when it hits an interface.
Yeah. So we have another correction to make, David. wow. Okay. So the emission spectrum is the actual light that's emitted, okay, without any interference from gases or other material in between. Here's an example of the emission spectrum of hydrogen.
Iron.
I'm sorry, iron. Notice that the separation of spectral lines is generally greater at lower energies, okay? So you get more of a spread down here in the red, which is the lower energy part of the spectrum. And as you get to higher energies, it becomes almost continuous. Every element has a unique identifying spectrum that can be used to definitively identify that element. So here's hydrogen. I don't know if you can see these. This is sodium with that yellow doublet. Helium, neon, and mercury. You see they're all different. I hope you can at least see that. They're all different and they're all unique. Any questions on that?
Okay. They look like they're all not different here.
Pardon?
I don't see where they're all different from here. They look like they're the same to me.
No. Look at the difference. For instance, this yellow line in sodium, look how it shifted to the right for helium.
So very little it talked.
It doesn't take much, but but there are other lines in helium that don't appear in sodium. There's a red line here, okay? There are green and looks like green lines here, okay? So we can definitely distinguish between helium and sodium and helium and anything else.
Are the colors? Are the green and the reds?
Yeah, exactly. So absorption spectrum, oh, thanks. Absorption spectrum are caused by the fraction of incident radiation absorbed by the material over a range of frequencies. So for example, as I said before, if you have a star and the light from the star comes through a planet's atmosphere, if it's rich in sodium, for example, we pass that light through a spectrograph and we get these two lines in the yellow, the doublet in sodium. And this is what it might look like on a graph, okay? So the actual strength of the line can be determined in that way by photoelectric detectors, okay? So it's primarily determined by the atomic and molecular composition of the intervening gas or other material. And it occurs at the same frequencies that match the emission spectra, which is the energy difference between two vibrational, rotational, or transitional states of molecules. The absorption that occurs is referred to as an absorption line, and a spectrum is typically composed of many lines. The first direct detection and chemical analysis of the atmosphere of an exoplanet was done in 2001. Sodium in the atmosphere filters the starlight of a star called the starlight of HD 209458 as the giant planet passes in front of the star. But we know there's sodium in the atmosphere of that planet. If we look at Io, the one of the moons of Jupiter, we can see that there is sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere in the same way. The picture of Io on the right. So you can see that absorption lines are occurring for sodium in the lab here and here. And in the same way, when we look at Io in the lower two, we see the same drops, the absorptions, at those exact same frequencies. Now, it turns out that temperature has an effect on the ionization of atoms. And as we'll see in a moment, when an atom becomes ionized, that has an effect on the spectrum. Okay? So it's kind of an eventual effect. The key to understanding stellar spectra is that the degree of ionization for various atoms depends strongly on the temperature. Well, that makes sense. Heat is energy, right? And the more energy that's available, the more likely it is that an electron will actually be ripped away from its atom. Okay? Okay, I referred to some plots that I didn't put up here. Hydrogen is present almost entirely in the form of neutral hydrogen for temperatures below about 7,000 degrees Kelvin. But above that temperature, there's a rapid transition, so that above about 10,000 degrees Kelvin, The hydrogen is present almost completely as ionized hydrogen. So below 7,000 degrees, you know, the hydrogen atoms don't lose electrons. But as the temperature goes up, it starts to lose them, and above 10,000, the hydrogen is all ionized. It's just a proton, a free proton. Okay? And between 7,000 and 10,000, there's a mix, okay? There's some hydrogen ions and some hydrogen atoms. Below about 12,000 degrees Kelvin, helium is present primarily as neutral helium. But from that temperature up to about 29,000 degrees Kelvin, helium is primarily in the first ionized state. So it's lost one electron. And above 29,000 degrees Kelvin, most helium is completely ionized. It has lost both of its electrons. So these are the spectral classes of stars. Remember that class O is the hottest star. Class X, S the coolest, well, M the coolest. These are kind of odd states down here, okay? And you remember, as I like to say, oh, be a fine girl, kiss me right now, smack. You're supposed to laugh now. Thank you. Very enthusiastic crowd today.
Thanks for letting us know.
So, let's start with the coolest, the M-type stars, okay? Titanium oxide molecular lines dominate and neutral metals, okay? Not much ionization, okay? These stars are very cool. As the temperature goes up, neutral metals and molecular lines begin to appear in K. In G, singly ionized calcium is strong, hydrogen is weaker, and neutral metals. G, by the way, is the class of our own sun, okay? It's called the G2. Each class is subdivided 0 to 9, okay, as it gets hotter. In F-type stars, a little bit hotter than the sun, hydrogen is even weaker, neutral and singly ionized metals come in. In A-type stars, the Balmer hydrogen lines dominant. That's the ones we saw in the previous slide, in a previous slide. B-type stars, neutral helium, ionized metals, and a stronger hydrogen. And then in O-type stars, ionized helium and very weak hydrogen.
You mean weak in the sense of not being much?
Weak, neutral. In other words, it's all ionized. Yeah, it's all ionized.
Well, if it's neutral, it's not ionized.
It says weak hydrogen, okay? Which means there's not much neutral hydrogen. It's all ionized, okay? So the point I'm trying to make is, as it gets hotter, you get more ions, okay? And it's generally true of all elements. Yes, sir.
The sun temperature has increased since it was created. Does that mean it was an S star at one time and lost, or maybe an O star as it gets hotter?
Yeah, right. It was cooler. I don't think it was an S. It may have been a K or an M initially. Okay, but as it collected more mass and it began to compress, got hotter.
What was that Shapley said?
Pardon? So here you can see the ionization effect on the strength of the spectral line. So let me point this out. It's kind of hard to see. But if you look at a star, in an A-class star at the bottom, okay, and we're looking at hot stars with surface temperatures greater than 10,000 degrees. This is the Balmer series of hydrogen lines, okay? And you can see maybe this one is pretty stable up to about here, and then it begins to shrink and go away. So the Balmer series is for neutral hydrogen, okay? So the neutral hydrogen spectrum is changing as more ions are produced. Okay? And you can see a weakening of most of the spectral lines in the Balmer series as we get hotter and hotter. This one drops off very rapidly from about here on up. Okay? Can you see that? So by looking at the strength of the spectral line, we can determine the amount of ionization and therefore the temperature of the star. Okay? It's a very valuable thing to know. Because once we know the temperature of the star, we know generally where it fits in on the main sequence. We know its mass. We know it's generally its lifetime. Okay? If we know its mass, then if we detect a planet and we can measure how long it takes the planet to go around the star, if it crosses in front of the star, then we know the mass of the planet. And when we know the mass of the planet, then we know if it can retain an atmosphere. And if we know the composition of the atmosphere, then we can determine pretty much. Well, we also, by the way, knowing the mass, we know how far away the planet is from the star. So we know if liquid water could exist on that planet, because we know the temperature of the star, we know the distance, we know the mass of the planet, we know the composition of its atmosphere. We know the mass of the planet because we know that if its orbital period is something is known, and we know the mass of the star. No, if we know how fast it's moving.
There's a distance from the sun. The mass of the planet.
Let's go through step by step, okay? If we know the period of the orbit. Yeah. Okay.
We know the mass of the sun. We don't have to think about the mass of the planet.
Well, if we know the gravitational attraction of the star for the planet, okay? We know the gravitational force. We know the centrifugal reaction, okay, what that must be. And part of the centrifugal reaction is the mass of the planet. Mv squared over r must equal gmm over r squared. And one of those m's is the mass of the planet. Okay? Yeah.
You can estimate the mass from the size of the planet. See by how long it takes to the eclipse.
Right.
I think that's really the way they go.
Yeah. We know, what I'm getting at is we know if that planet could support life as we know it, in terms of allowing water to remain in its liquid state on the surface of the planet. So that's what they're constantly looking at in the some 6,000 exoplanets that they found so far. Not very many of them can, but they found some that can. So this was kind of interesting. I started to look at the origin of the elements. So here's a periodic chart of the elements. Hydrogen is in the upper left corner. Come all the way across to helium. The reactivity of the elements you can look at in terms of which column they're in. For example, helium is an inert gas. It has a complete outer shell, okay, valence shell. And all of the gases in this column are inert. neon, argon, krypton, xenon, and radon. Okay? They do not combine readily with other substances. Okay? On the other hand, if you look at the column just to the left, you have fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, something, I don't know what that is.
Astatine.
Astatine. These are very reactive, okay? They combine very readily with other substances. So you'll notice chlorine combines, for example, very readily with potassium. Potassium has just one valence electron. Chlorine has seven. Seven and one, eight, the magic number, right? So it completes an outer shell, and so potassium chloride is a very common salt. Sodium chloride, right? In fact, all of these, cesium chloride, francium chloride, rubidium chloride, lithium chloride, and of course, hydrogen chloride, which is hydrochloric acid. Okay? So, looking at it from an astronomical point of view, the ones in blue were elements that occurred because of fusion that started about 3 seconds after the Big Bang. Very quick. So hydrogen, helium. Okay? The green are elements that come from stars that are low mass and are fading, okay? So we have carbon and nitrogen and some of the more esoteric elements down here. Not all of which I know. Let's see, that's mercury, isn't it? Yeah. Okay, strontium, barium, ytterbium, zirconium, so on. Tin, I recognize tin. Indium, tellurium. The yellow are elements that come from massive stars that explode, supernovae, okay? So we get oxygen, fluorine, neon, sodium, magnesium, potassium, calcium, rubidium, and some of these others. Okay, aluminum, silicon. Those elements did not exist at the Big Bang. Okay, they came about because higher temperatures were required to cause those elements to fuse. The grayish green elements are down here. And these elements have only been found by lab experiments. They've been produced in the laboratory. They have not been found in nature.
Why?
Their half-lives are very short. They don't exist for very long. Okay? In fact, even in the lab, I mean, you have to be right there to capture them. Okay? And how do they capture them? Well, first of all, they allow a very high-speed particle to hit a nearby element, and the resulting spray of particles includes particles that move in a magnetic and electric field with a certain arc. And by knowing the radius of that arc, we know the mass. We know the mass of an element. We know if it exists already or if it's something new. So when they find something new, so we found another element. Okay. Cosmic ray fission.
Question.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, even in spite of their short half-lives, have the spectrum of any of those very heavy elements ever been observed in stars?
That's a good question. I don't think so. But, yeah. I would say, I would say that probably not. I mean, they haven't been found in nature. So
I'm not sure they make enough to actually get a spectrum.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, there would have to be enough of them.
Material,
yeah. Yeah, because otherwise, if they did produce a spectrum, it'd be so weak, we probably wouldn't be able to see it. Yeah. Well, I'm not certain, but I think maybe they were able to get spectra from them in a laboratory setting, you know. They might be able to. Again, you need enough of it to be able to actually analyze it.
What are the emerging neutron stars? It seems like that's responsible for a lot of critical elements.
Yeah, well, when if a star becomes so dense that atoms cannot exist because of the strong forces, then neutrons may be all that's left. And if two neutron stars are gravitationally attracted to each other, then the collision might produce these other elements.
Is that where they got the gravitational waves? They were two merging in the neutron stars?
I'm not sure if it was neutron stars or black holes. Yeah.
But they have to be dispersed.
Yeah. You have to be there when it happens.
Yeah, a collision that sprays the stuff out so that we can get it in the Earth's crust.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, and that's the interesting thing, is a lot of these elements did not exist at the Big Bang. It took the exploding stars, which took a lot longer than fusion to occur after the Big Bang. So it took a while before some of these other elements were sprayed out into space and eventually came into a cloud of gas that eventually formed the Earth.
So, fusion in the Big Bang, what's actually fusing?
Hydrogen.
No, but nitrogen, that's what formed the nitrogen, according to what the chart says.
So well, nitrogen came from dying stars, so that was later.
No, I'm talking about helium.
Oh, helium?
Isn't that Big Bang?
Yeah, yeah.
Hydrogen, helium.
Yeah, because the hydrogen.
What's that formed from? What fuses?
Hydrogen.
Hydrogen turned into helium.
Yeah. High temperature will cause hydrogen atoms to fuse, okay, and produce helium.
Well, that's what produced the helium.
I think the point is that the Big Bang temperatures are so high that only quarks were kind of.
That's what I would think too.
And then so it's a cool down, right? They sort of coalesce it somewhere in the helium and somewhere in the hydrogen.
So the quarks fuse.
The quarks form protons, neutrons, and electrons.
And they fuse in the hydrogen.
Right.
Like
a cool down and those.
You also notice I marked on this chart the elements that are common in the human body. Hydrogen, and you know, because it's in water, right? Carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, sodium, magnesium, potassium, calcium, phosphorus, sulfur, chlorine. Okay? So notice where they came from. They came after the Big Bang. So they came from either dying stars or exploding stars. So it wasn't until we had stars that were sufficiently aged in order to either die or explode, that we had elements that could actually become part of human life. Life forms,
iron,
mammals.
Iron doesn't have a star.
I'm sorry?
It's iron. It's a hemoglobin. You're iron in your body for your blood cells.
I don't think it's the most common, though. Not sure. I have another chart that might go into that a little bit more, I think.
Yeah, I'd like to see that.
So if we look at the abundance of elements in the Earth's continental crust, The rarest elements in the crust are shown in yellow and are not the heaviest. These are the iron-loving elements in something called the Goldschmidt classification of elements. These have been depleted by being relocated deeper into the Earth's core. Okay? So we have elements like, let me see if I can identify some of these for you. Cadmium, silver, tin, rubidium. Some of these I don't recognize. Lead, there's lead right there. Lead and tin, okay, are fairly abundant. Okay? The rock-forming elements are elements such as lithium, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, silicon, aluminum, sodium, potassium, calcium, the more common, okay? The major industrial metals, I'm sorry?
Between the on the right up on top of the yellow that are common, what's the one in the middle going up higher?
This one?
No.
Here?
Yeah, that one.
Barium.
Why would that go higher? What's that? Up?
I don't know.
I mean, why would it do that?
The major industrial metals are in red.
I know.
So you notice they're mostly down here. The precious metals are in purple. Okay? That's why I don't recognize the names. And the rare earth metals are in blue. Oh, that's blue,
that's
not purple. What is purple?
That's down below. The gold and platinum and the
Silver, yeah. The precious metals in purple is silver. This one. No, that's not.
So what color is the one that's all the way on the top? The one that I mentioned?
Here?
Yeah, one I was mentioning before. Can't see the color.
Barium.
Between the two reds, under the yellow. Over the yellow. Over the yellow.
Between these
the
two?
The high one.
This one?
That one. What color is it?
That's barium.
What color is
it? Oh, what color is it?
Yeah.
Black, I think.
No, white. Why is it black?
Yeah. It's not classified in any of those categories.
I mean, all this represents is the abundance of the elements in a nebular cloud that formed the solar system.
Right,
It doesn't say anything about anything really other than just the data.
But the interesting thing is, and this will bring us back to Payne, these elements exist in the sun with about the same proportion. So that means that when the sun began to form, the nebular cloud that it came from was also the source of the Earth. The chemical composition of the Earth's crust, the sun, and in fact the moon, and rock planets in general, Venus and Mars, Mercury, is about the same proportions of elements.
Well, that's why Russell said what he said.
Yeah, exactly.
But he was slightly off a little bit.
Yeah. So what I've done here, these are the 20 most common elements in the universe, okay? And yeah, iron is not among them, okay?
Why?
Because it's not.
I know, but why, isn't it?
Well,
iron is really important here on Earth.
So importance has nothing to do with it, okay?
Part of the problem is in the diffusion of when different suns collapse, iron is sort of a minimal point for energy.
Yeah.
So that's why it's so rare, basically.
Yeah. So you have hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, sodium, magnesium, phosphorus, sulfur, chlorine, potassium, and calcium. Are these elements are the ones that make up the human body. Okay. And they are among the 20 most common elements in the universe. Not a surprise, right? Not a surprise. Now, if an atom absorbs sufficient energy, it may eject the electron, okay, becoming an ion. There is some controversy about the effects of ions on health, although there seems to be general agreement that if you have an excess of positive ions, it has a detrimental effect on health. So there are some ionizing air purifiers, okay, that provide an excess of negative ions. Basically, that's what they're doing. They're pumping out electrons, okay? So it's not universally recognized that these are advantageous.
Isn't there a concept called grounding, where they tell people basically to take their shoes off and walk outside on the earth for like an hour a day? I've read that. They said apparently it's something to do
really?
With the exchange of electrons.
Yeah. Yeah, I never heard that. Yeah.
I've heard of it. A couple MDs are pushing it.
Really?
And that's been surprising.
Are they foot doctors, podiatrists?
These are really
yeah, well, the closer you get to the dirt and the earth,
dogs don't wear shoes.
They don't?
They don't live very long either.
Yeah. There you go.
No, but the dirt,
that's called one data point, right?
But the dirt in the ground is really, really healthy. The closer you get to the dirt and the ground,
yeah.
Excess
hydrogen ions are dangerous in your bloodstream, okay? Many amino acids are sensitive to the number of positive hydrogen ions. As the level of positive hydrogen ions goes up, the ions will start sticking to the amino acids. Those amino acids may then lose a charge if they were negatively charged, or gain a positive charge if they were neutral. And these charge changes will likely disrupt attractions that were holding the protein together, and it will begin to fall apart. One protein that's affected is hemoglobin, the oxygen carrier. So increases in hydrogen ion, positive hydrogen ion concentration decreases the hemoglobin's ability to carry oxygen. In tissue, high hydrogen ion levels could lead to disastrous consequences. You suffocate.
Hemoglobin's blood, is that what they are?
So we need to control the levels of positive hydrogen ions. Too low of a hydrogen ion concentration could also have similarly disastrous consequences. In other words, you have to be careful with some of these ionizing purifiers.
I know, they were really selling it.
Because you're playing around with the percentages of positive and negative ions. After the Big Bang, equilibrium ionization, which is described by this Indian scientist called Saha, explain evolution in the early universe. After the Big Bang, all atoms were ionized, okay? So you mainly had just free protons and electrons swirling about, okay? According to Saha, when the universe had expanded and cooled such that the temperature reached about 3,000 degrees Kelvin, electrons recombined with protons. So you began to have atoms, and that formed hydrogen atoms. The simplest atom, of course. One proton, one electron. Suddenly, the universe became transparent to most radiation. That 3,000 degree Kelvin surface redshifted by a factor of about 1,000, because it was moving away very rapidly, generates a 3,000 Kelvin cosmic background radiation, which bathes the universe today. So even though it's getting further and further away, okay, and it's getting weaker and weaker, we can still see that background radiation that occurred at the Big Bang.
Well, it's picked up as radio
static. Yeah, and that's how it was found.
Yeah.
Yeah. and the Hadean Ian, which is about 4.6 billion years in the past, hellish conditions existed on the Earth. The Earth began to cool. In the Earth's early formation, the atmosphere had hydrogen, helium, methane, and H3. What's that?
Ammonia.
Ammonia, carbon dioxide, and water vapor. Because of the weak gravity, and this is still happening today, hydrogen and helium are lost to space. Why is that? Well, hydrogen and helium are the lightest of elements. So atoms of hydrogen and helium gas will go to the top of the atmosphere, okay? So they will be the furthest away from the Earth or at the point of weakest gravity. So that's one factor. The second factor is they're the lightest, okay? So at a given temperature, and temperature, remember, is basically a measure of molecular speed, these atoms are going to be moving most rapidly. And so many of them, not all of them at a given time, but many of them will actually be moving faster than the velocity needed to escape from the Earth's gravity. So we are constantly leaking hydrogen and helium into space. Okay? So that's why we don't find hydrogen and helium in our atmosphere, fortunately for us. Okay? At the same time, solar wind, which still exists today, which is caused by a constant stream of particles and radiation from the sun, blew away by collision, okay, a lot of other gases. Earth's first enduring atmosphere was produced by what's called outgassing, or gases that escape from the Earth's interior, mainly through volcanic activity. There were hundreds of active volcanoes at one time, and so huge amounts of gas were released into the atmosphere. Water vapor, carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide, and minor amounts of other gases were released. So where did the oxygen come from? Well, we think that it was brought here primarily by meteorites, asteroids, and other objects that may have hit the Earth. No, in water.
In water.
Water vapor, yeah.
Well, that's how it came
out. Yeah. What we see is, for example, with Jupiter, the atmosphere is 90% hydrogen, about 10% helium. Good question is, why didn't Jupiter become a star? And the answer is, as massive as it is, it didn't create enough temperature due to compression, due to gravitational forces that were compressing it to become a star. I asked my astronomy professor how big or how massive Jupiter would have to be a star. And he said it would still have to be about 800 times more massive. Saturn is also a gas giant, okay, with about 97% hydrogen, only 3% helium. Uranus is 83% hydrogen, 15% helium, and 2% methane. It's not as massive as Jupiter and Saturn. And when you get down to Neptune, it's 74% hydrogen, 25% helium, 1% methane. It is less massive than the others.
So those planets are big enough so the gravitational force
holds the hydrogen in?
Jupiter and Saturn. Oh, well, yeah, all of them. Yeah. Uh-huh. They're much more massive than the Earth.
So they have enough gravity to hold.
Yes, yes. Hydrogen. Right. In fact, it's thought that there probably is no solid surface to Jupiter until you get really way down. I mean, to say you were standing on Jupiter is probably a misnomer or a misleading statement, because there probably isn't really a solid surface until you get very far into the planet.
So what's the mass? But it's still got a big mass.
Oh, sure. Jupiter has a mass about 99% of the mass of the solar system, all the other planets combined.
Even though it's dense.
Yeah. It's huge. It's huge.
It's still collapsing.
And that's why it's able to hold 67 moons in orbit.
I was just going to say, for Uranus and Neptune, another reason that they have such a high percentage of hydrogen and helium is simply that the leakage of the gases out into space would be very low simply because of the very low temperature.
Yeah, again, that's the other part of it, right? I should mention that. Because the reason hydrogen and helium escape from the Earth is we're close enough to the sun that the temperature is high enough to raise the speed of those atoms. By the time you get out to Jupiter, the temperature has dropped considerably. Yeah, so they're not moving as fast. So that combined with the additional gravity keeps the gases in the atmosphere.
So how do they measure the amount of hydrogen in Jupiter's state?
The strength of the spectral line.
No, but is it the reflected light that comes back to us?
Yes, yes, exactly.
So you don't actually have to look at the light going through the atmosphere of Jupiter.
Right. Because whatever light strikes it, certain frequencies will be absorbed, right? And what is reflected is not absorbed. So we see dark lines in the spectrum. It's an absorption spectrum, okay? And of course, for planets like Venus, when Venus goes across the face of the sun, then we can examine the absorption in Venus's atmosphere.
Right.
Yeah.
Just like you do an exoplanet.
Right, exactly. So this is what happened at the Big Bang. This is where the Big Bang occurred, okay? And it says space-time description breaks down, okay? So we think that time and space started at the Big Bang, that before the Big Bang there was no time. Then we had at 10 to the minus 35 seconds, very, very shortly after the Big Bang, the electroweak and strong nuclear forces became separated. This is a period called inflation. There was a tremendous expansion in the universe. So when somebody asks you, where did the Big Bang occur? What would you say? Where did it occur?
Everywhere.
Exactly. Everywhere. Okay. Then we had at 0.01 billionths of a second, the electroweak transition. Okay, which is right here. Then at 1 microsecond, 1 millionth of a second, protons and neutrons were formed. And then,
that fast?
At 3 minutes, we had some light elements that were created, deuterium, helium, and lithium. Nuclear fusion actually began. At 3 minutes.
Well, the quark, that's when the hydrogen was formed, the protons.
Right, so deuterium is hydrogen, yeah.
Well, what?
Deuterium is hydrogen, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So all this happened really, really, really fast, and then it merged?
Nothing much happened for another 5,000 years.
Well.
And then there was a domination of matter in the universe and the onset of gravitational collapse, which would eventually lead to the formation of stars and planets. Then we entered at 400,000 years, what is called recombination. Atoms were formed, okay? And the background radiation disappeared. The formation of additional background radiation stopped, okay? Then it took another several hundred million years before we saw the earliest visible galaxies. It's 700 million years. Star formation seemed to peak at about 3 billion years. In other words, if we look at the ages of stars, we know that from their place on the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram and their frequency of existence as we scan all the stars in the universe that we can look at, well, in the galaxy anyway, okay? So we can form a population distribution for stars. We think the solar system formed about 5 billion years ago, okay? 4.5 to 5 billion years ago. And dark energy dominated at 11 billion years. And today, life on Earth came in relatively recently. And today we think the universe is about 13.8 billion years old. So there's different kinds of burning that exist that form the higher or heavier elements. Helium burning consists of the combination of two helium nuclei, which produce gamma radiation and formed an element called beryllium. And beryllium, it turns out, is a very interesting element, reading up on it. Turns out it's if it gets into your body, it can't be eliminated. It just builds up, and it can eventually poison you. It's very dangerous. Beryllium then breaks down into, it forms if it collides with helium. And remember, the helium nuclei are moving very rapidly, so they're colliding again and again in space with high temperature. And so beryllium colliding with helium can form carbon-12, which is fairly stable. Okay, so that's how we can get beryllium and we can get carbon. I'll have to read this to you, it's hard to read. But carbon burning means carbon-12 combines and can form neon, helium, and then sodium, and then magnesium, and oxygen, okay? So carbon burning, if a star gets hot enough, the carbon will burn, okay, and form these other elements. And it doesn't have to get hot for very long. It may be exploding, you know, to get that hot. And so the other elements are sprayed out into space in a supernova. And then silicon will burn and form these other elements. I know some of them. Sulfur, argon, calcium, titanium, chromium, iron, nickel, and zinc. So we're getting, you know, to the point where you can see that many of the common elements are formed as the temperature goes up. So first you fuse hydrogen, then you fuse helium, okay? Then you fuse carbon, then you fuse silicon.
But they're formed in a nova, right? A supernova?
Yeah, yeah. Because you need such high temperatures.
That's where
yeah.
you get the temperature from.
And so as they begin to run out of fuel and compress, the temperature begins to go up. And if the compression is fast enough, and I'm talking about a matter of seconds.
Yeah. And what's left over is a black hole or a neutron star.
Right. So Earth's first atmosphere was hydrogen helium from the solar nebula, the cloud of gas from which the sun and the solar system was formed. And that was lost to the solar wind. The second atmosphere was water vapor, carbon dioxide, and sulfur dioxide from volcanic degassing. And so some of the gases were transformed by photosynthesis, which changed carbon dioxide into oxygen. And the current atmosphere is nitrogen and oxygen from photosynthesis and constant production of nitrogen. So we have 78% nitrogen, 21% oxygen, and 1% of other trace gases. I'm sorry?
Where did nitrogen come from?
Good question. Where did nitrogen come from? It wasn't back here, was it?
It wouldn't be made on the Earth, that's for sure.
No. I'll have to look it up.
It might have been methane. Is it methane?
Methane. Oh, methane, yeah. Methane is
CH4.
CH4, yeah. Ammonia.
Where did ammonia come from?
Where did ammonia come from? Well, it's a combination of hydrogen.
You had that on one of the
charts. It was back here.
The process is to create the elements, so energetic that you want to create in compound.
Here.
So there is early
formation of Earth. In Earth's early formation, the atmosphere had NH3. Yeah.
But you don't have any formation of nitrogen from this chart.
No, I'll have to look that up.
Yeah. Yeah. The solar wind is moderated by the Earth's magnetic field. Mm-hmm. And if that weren't the case, we would not have any atmosphere like Mars.
Yeah, the ions that are coming out of the sun come down, align themselves with the magnetic field.
Otherwise, the solar wind would erode the atmosphere and we'd have no atmosphere at all.
Amazing. What a pleasant thought.
Just the right film out.
Yeah.
In the beginning, it was all those volcanoes and things. So now that we're getting all these volcanoes and things again, what does that mean? I mean, a lot of people.
No, they're not nearly as frequent as they were in the past.
So it's no danger then there?
Not from that, no. That
wouldn't be. Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Photosynthesis. Where did photosynthesis come from? We think today that photosynthesis is a result of plantation.
Right. Yeah. Right, plants. So it took microorganisms and plants to begin the photosynthesis process.
Yeah, wouldn't there been any microorganisms or plants? The early Earth, it would have been too hot,
etc.
So, when did photosynthesis start?
Well,
as the Earth cooled down.
As the Earth cooled, yeah. As the Earth cooled. Okay. Here's a good term for you. Metallicity describes the abundance of elements present in an object that are heavier than hydrogen or helium. This is a term astronomers use because not all of those elements are metal, okay? But stars and nebulae with relatively high abundances of carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and neon are called metal-rich in astrophysical terms, even though those elements are non-metals in chemistry. The presence of heavier elements hails from stellar nucleosynthesis. The theory that the majority of elements heavier than hydrogen and helium in the universe are formed in the cores of stars as they evolve. Over time, stellar winds and supernovae deposit the metals into the surrounding environment, enriching the interstellar medium and providing recycling materials for the birth of new stars. It follows that older generations of stars, which formed in the metal-poor early universe, generally have lower metallicities than those of younger generations, which formed in a more metal-rich universe. Observed changes in the chemical abundances of different types of stars based on the spectral peculiarities that were later attributed to metallicity led astronomer Walter Bade in 1944 to propose the existence of two different populations of stars. These became known commonly as population 1, which are metal rich, and population 2, metal poor. A third stellar population was introduced in 1978, known as population 3, which are extremely metal poor stars and were theorized to have been the firstborn stars created in the universe.
So number them backwards.
It's degressing.
I'm sorry?
Is it degressing? It's going backwards now?
No. No, of course, the extremely metal poor stars are going to be the first ones to die out. Okay. Yeah. They're the oldest.
Are there any of those still around? The metal poor stars?
Yeah. But not very many. So the young universe was denser, hotter, and formed with a uniform glow from a white-hot fog of hydrogen plasma. When the universe cooled enough, protons and electrons combined to form neutral hydrogen atoms. These newly conceived atoms could not scatter the thermal radiation, so the universe became transparent instead of being an opaque fog. Neutral atoms first formed in the recombination epoch and the event shortly afterwards when photons started to travel freely through space, rather than constantly being scattered by electrons and protons in plasma. The photons that existed at the time of photon decoupling have been propagating ever since. They're very far away, they're getting further, they're growing fainter and less energetic, okay? The wavelength increases over time. They're moving away from us rapidly, more and more rapidly as we see. So the wavelength, the Doppler effect, stretches out the wavelength, which in effect lowers the frequency. So they're in the infrared range. And by the way, the Webb Space Telescope, I think it's supposed to go up now in 2021, is supposed to be very sensitive in infrared. So they're going to be looking for this type of radiation. And this is called relic radiation. The surface of last scattering refers to the set of points in space at the right distance from us so that we are now receiving photons originally emitted from those points at that decoupling. We're looking back in time. In summary then, Cecilia Payne was able to explain the spectral patterns of stars by relating temperature to ionized hydrogen and helium atoms. She was one of the first female astronomy PhD graduates from Harvard. She was the first female chair of the astronomy department at Harvard. Her work established the predominance of hydrogen and helium as the major composition of stars, and the similar distribution of all our elements in the Sun and the Earth. At first, the spectral sequence was thought to reflect different compositions for different stars. Payne showed that the different spectral types are primarily a consequence of different surface temperatures for the stars, with composition differences playing only a minor role. Hydrogen and helium escaped from Earth's atmosphere, and photosynthesis converted carbon dioxide into oxygen, which gave us our present atmosphere. an interesting story, and I think in all my studies of astronomy, no one ever mentioned Payne. She was forgotten. So I hope I brought her, a memory of her, back into light.
The Russell chart has temperature on the bottom, right?
Right.
Which is something that she did later on.
Yeah.
So then how did he, so somewhere there's a mix up. Because you couldn't have had the Russell Hertzberg chart.
Well, all they did was relate temperature to luminosity. The vertical axis is luminosity.
Right.
It's brightness.
And they had the temperature, though. The Russell chart, wasn't that in 1910 or?
No, I think it was later than
Payne.
Was it
later?
Yeah.
Now that she and women are being acknowledged slightly, or whatever you want to call it, why don't you bring her up and have her acknowledged? Why don't you have the scientists become aware of what she really did instead of their high hats?
She probably deserved a Nobel Prize, but yeah, because of what Russell did, her contribution may not have been recognized. She was not nominated. You have to be nominated, you know, so.
So nominate her.
Well, they only nominate living persons.
Too late.
No, you can't get a Nobel Prize after you pass away.
Well, her ancestors could take it for
her. No. Sorry. Okay, see you next. Oh, next week?
Yeah, close.
They're closed, okay?
So,
I'll send you an email to that effect.
If you come here, you gotta give a lecture outside.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I'll see you in 2 weeks, okay?
Okay.